Welcome back to Let's Code. Today we have a Tori app, specifically a menu bar app. So it may not look much like a menu bar app because I still have the window right here. But if we go up into the menu bar up here, you can see I've got OBS recording right here. And here we have our menu bar app. So we've got a quit button, a hide button, and a couple of like launcher links. So quick links for Netlify, YouTube, and my Twitter account, and quick links for a couple of GitHub repos, the Rust Adventure organization, as well as the Bevy Engine repo, which are repositories that I, you know, visit quite frequently. So if we click up here in the menu bar, hide, the window goes away. And here we can show it again and it'll come back. The application dock still has an icon in it, which is a deficiency of Tori at the moment. So you can't do like a full, let's say, Alfred application where it just pops up overlaid on top of everything without having the menu dock and things like that. So there's a couple of APIs that Tori still needs to implement as far as I understand it, but we can still get rid of this window. We just can't get rid of the application icon in the dock. And then just to prove that this link works, I can click on the Bevy link and wow, that is small, isn't it? It sends us to the Bevy repo. I swear it really does. Let me just make this big, I suppose. Of course, this is the moment that Arc is going to compete with me for what I want it to do. So there you can see that the Bevy GitHub repo is the link that opens in my default browser of choice. The reason it opens in this little thing right here is because I'm using Arc. I don't like this little Arc thing that pops up. It kind of gets in my way more than not. I usually want a full browser, but that's an Arc problem. That's not a Tori problem. So I'm just going to get rid of that and we're going to move on. So the other thing that you can see is if I get rid of this window, usually the application on macOS closes, but the menu bar is still up here for us to use. And on the left-hand side, before I get rid of the terminal, I'll just point out that the ID of each thing that we're clicking is being logged out in the left-hand side. So if you decide to clone this repo and run it yourself on your operating system of choice, know that this is the ID of the link that we are, or the more accurately, the menu item that we're clicking. So let's get rid of that and let's get into the actual code. Now, what I've done with the GitHub repo is I've split it up into two commits. The first commit is the scaffolding. So I ran npx create Tori app. I created a Vite application. I used React, but I haven't touched the JavaScript at all. So yeah, there could be no window here. It wouldn't matter. If we wanted to get rid of the window, we could get rid of this windows key in tori.conf.json and our application wouldn't even show a window when we started it up. The other thing that I'll note is that to create a system tray icon, you need to use the Tori system tray set of configurations. In this case, we've set it to icons icon.png, which comes with the template, which is just the Tori icon. So it's this little double circle thing. And then the only other changes that we made are to main.rs. So you can see that all of the modules that we're using here are Tori APIs. They are not third-party APIs. We aren't using any additional crates other than Tori. And here I've chosen to set up our menu structure as a const for a set of links. That is just a 5-element array of 3 tuples. So each of these has an ID as the first identifier, the name that you see in the menu as the second, and then the link to open as the third. And that's what builds these submenus here for us. So let's start out with main and let's go down to the Tori builder, because the Tori builder is really where everything kicks off. Now we've got this Tori builder. We do the default. We use dot system tray. The dot system tray is what gives us this nice menu in the system tray, or the menu bar as it's called on macOS. We have an event handler that you can see on line 83. This is a function that takes the app handle and the event that happens on the system tray icon. We then have our actual Tori application split up into build and run. Run is something that we use because we need to match on these run events, specifically because when we close out that original window, you know, I was testing it before and so I had the window up. When we close that out, we don't want our application to exit. So we are using the Tori exit requested variant with the API that comes with it to prevent the application from exiting, because exiting is the default behavior. And that's fundamentally it. We set up the system tray using some structs, we listen to events, and we do things in reaction to those events. So working our way backwards from that, we want to create a system tray to pass into this system tray function. So we can do that with system tray new, and we do that with a system tray menu, basically. This system tray menu also has a builder, so all of these are going to be builder APIs, at which point we can add any number of items that we want. In this case, we're adding a custom menu item, which takes the ID and the display name. We add both of our submenus, which are constructed in the same way, as we'll see. The only native items that we can add to this dropdown here are dividers. So this divider horizontal line right here is this separator. And then we add another custom menu item with a ID of visibility toggle and a display name of hide, which we can update later. So if we boot up our application again, the window will pop up and we can see hide here. We click it, it goes away. We click it again, it says show. So that's our basic tray menu. So we're setting up the base set of options, quit, social, GitHub, and show. Quit being an item, social and GitHub being submenus, and hide being another item. Both of the submenus are built in the same exact way. We take this set of links up here and I filter them. So we've got a system tray menu new. I set that equal to a menu. And then we check the links. We iterate over them. We filter for any of the IDs that start with open-social. So I've chosen to do a ID naming convention. So open social, we'll put it in the first submenu. And open GitHub, we'll put it in the second menu with the ordering that we've described here. So we take this menu, which is a system tray menu, and inside of this loop for all of the valid items that we need to add, we'll add an item using the custom menu item like we did before with an ID and the label. And because this function returns basically a new menu, we have to set our menu equal to the new result. And then we construct the system tray submenu with a label and the menu that we just created, so the system tray menu. And it's the same thing for social and for GitHub. So that is what constructs each of our submenus. So you can see the original label for the submenu in the root menu, as well as the labels for each of the items in the submenu. But that still leaves us with needing to handle things like clicks on the menu items. So we have this on system tray event, which I'll remind you was added as an event handler on the Tori builder. We get a reference, a shared reference to the app handle and a system tray event. We match on this event, in which case we don't care if it's not a menu item click. If it is a menu item click, we grab the ID of the menu item and we process it. The item handle is accessible through app.trayHandle.getItem via that ID. We debug that ID out, which is what we saw in the terminal earlier. And then we have to match on this ID as a string so that we get this like nice readable match. In the first case, we get visibility toggle. Visibility toggle is this show hide button. So it's the button that is updating or having its text updated when every time we click it. For this, we get the main window, which in our case will never fail, but will fail if we take this window away and that window doesn't exist, then this get window main will fail because we don't have a window. And we would need to programmatically generate a window if we wanted to see it. With that window that we've gotten, we can check if it's visible or not. Is visible returns a result with a Boolean value inside of it. So there are some errors that can happen that I am currently not handling. So I'm using the unimplemented macro to, just in case any error happens, this will panic and put out what kind of errors happen here. Otherwise, we get either a true or a false value, in which case we either window.hide or window.show. And we also use the set title function on the item handle. If you remember, the item handle is the item that we have in our menu up here. So it's either show or hide, and that's it. If quit comes through, we'll just exit the app. And then we have some special handling for all of the open URLs. So because I've used open dash as the starting string for all of the IDs for all of the URLs, we can use a guard in this match. So instead of matching on a specific string, we can match on this variable. So any string will match this. And then we can have an if statement here. So if s.starts with open, then it matches. So this will only handle strings that start with open dash. And then we also have this underscore at the end to handle any other ID that would fall through. If it does start with open, then we use iflet with a destructuring here on links.iter.find. So we look inside of the links array for the ID that matches the ID that's coming in, so S. This will return an option. So it's either going to be something that we found or something that we didn't. So if we match and destructure on that option, we can match on some link, destructuring the link value out, but only if this value is not none. If this value is none, we do nothing. And then finally, once we have the link value, link.to is the URL, so we can use the open API, which requires the shell scope and something else that we're not using, and that will open the link in the browser for us. So if we go back up once again, I can go in here, I can click on Rust Adventure. My default browser will pop up because we're using the macOS basically open API to open that URL, and it will send us to Rust Adventure. I could close this out, go back up here, go to YouTube, and it should be my YouTube channel. So that's it. It's not a like Alfred level complete example. It's not a super fancy pop the window up in the location kind of application. So there are menu apps, or there have been in the past, that have more features. And then there are some more complicated ones like this Bluetooth, which have even like a checkbox in the title bar here, as well as some icons and whether things are connected or not. Now, I don't think that this checkbox is possible in Tori right now without doing like a custom window approach, but maybe that's something we'll look into in the future. So this code is up on GitHub if you want to see it. Again, the first commit in the GitHub repo is just scaffolding, and the second commit is all of the Rust code and configuration that you need to actually create a system tray menu app. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you again in the next one. Have a great day.